My name is Mark Lopez. I work out of Congressman Pete Visclosky's office. We'd like to thank you for coming out and participating in the Congressman Pete Visclosky's East Chicago City Forum. Before we begin, I'd like to remind people, if you have any electronic devices on you, if you could please put them to silent or vibrate so as not to prove to be a distraction to others in attendance with us here this afternoon. To set the stage, Congressman Pete Visclosky will discuss issues affecting our nation as well as Northwest Indiana. Concluding his remarks, he will answer questions, starting first with those in the index cards that were offered to you as you entered the room. Those index cards provide you an opportunity to give us your address. In the event we can't answer your question, we can send you something in the mail. It also gives you the chance to sign up for our congressional electronic newsletter to receive updates on the legislative session upcoming. This year, we tried something a little different. If you had friends or family that were unable to participate, that wanted to, but due to work or social or family obligations, what have you, they can go to our website, which is also in the index card as www.house.gov/Visclosky. The website has a pre-recorded town form that was held earlier in the week. It also affords you the opportunity to click a button and submit a question as well. That will be up and running through the end of this weekend. We're joined here this afternoon with a couple local elected officials I'd like the opportunity to introduce, and join me in welcoming for coming out, Councilwoman Christine Vasquez. North Township Trustee Frank Mervan. We're also joined here today and have the privilege of having the mayor of the great city of East Chicago, Mayor Anthony Copeland, with us here. I also have the privilege of introducing a very talented and gifted young individual from the community who will start off the official town forum. Please join me in welcoming Cassandra Marquez.
Welcome to Congressman Pete Visclosky's town forum meeting. My name is Cassandra Marquez, and I am in the seventh grade at St. Stanislaus School. And I ask that you please stand and join me in saying the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
You may be seated. Mr. Visclosky represents Indiana's 1st Congressional District, which currently includes Lake, Porter, Jasper, Benton, and Newton counties. Born and raised in Northwest Indiana, Mr. Visclosky believes that the best way to address our nation's problems is to put aside party differences and work together to get things done. The principle guides him as he works to serve our troops and veterans, rebuild our economy, address our nation's budget deficit, and improve educational and economic opportunities for my generation. Throughout his time in office, Mr. Visclosky has fought for hardworking middle-class Americans by working to preserve and create good-paying jobs and economic stability. As vice chairman of the Congressional Steel Caucus, he has worked to protect existing jobs through programs like Buy America and create new jobs through public infrastructure investments. Mr. Visclosky has worked to make our neighborhoods and law enforcement officers more secure by writing legislation for programs like the Bulletproof Vest Partnership, improve our communities through projects like the Marquette Plan, and invest in our future through institutions like local universities and the Purdue Technology Center. Mr. Visclosky graduated from Andrean High School in Maryville. He earned a degree in accounting from North Indiana University Northwest, a law degree from the University of Notre Dame, and a master's degree in international comparative law from Georgetown University. He is married to Ms. Joanne Royce and has two sons, John and Tim Visclosky. And now, please join me in welcoming our Congressman, Mr. Pete Visclosky.
Acknowledge that some of you have been at our forums in the past. As you know, the students who helped us get this started are selected for their academic performance. Cassandra did say that she got out of a little school to help us this afternoon, but I don't think it's going to hurt her grade point average at all. very well-rounded, does a lot of athletics, including basketball and volleyball, volleyball being her favorite, but is an avid reader, which is my favorite thing to do, and reads a lot of science fiction as well. But do want to give her a certificate of appreciation. I do want to thank the mayor and our public officials who are here today, and all of you for coming out in very typical January Northwest Indiana weather for our annual Asian Chicago Forum. Before I begin, I do want to acknowledge that we had a tragedy that occurred this past Friday when we lost four members of the Indiana National Guard who were killed in Afghanistan, as well as a fifth of thank you very much. I appreciate again all of you for attending. Some were in this council chamber about a year ago when we met. And in reflecting back on 2011, I think most of us would conclude that it was a tough year. We still have an overarching deficit that we have to deal with. We still have an intractable unemployment problem as far as people looking for work. And as the tragedy of this past Friday has indicated to us again and reminded us, we are a nation at war. Pew Charitable Trust also has recently had a survey released that indicates 53% of all parents in the United States now believe that their children will have a lower standard of living than they have. And only 32% of the respondents felt that their economic circumstances were either excellent or good, less than a third of all of us. So clearly, as the second session of this Congress begins, there is much work to be done relative to the creation of jobs, finally attacking the deficit issue, again, remembering we are at war. Those who were here last year for the forum will remember that I held out the Indiana National Guard as an example of those who from East Chicago and across Indiana served and have served us in military uniform, particularly in combat. Very proud of the Guard and those who serve us. After last year's census in Indiana, we are now only the 16th most populous state in the nation, but our Guard unit remains the fourth largest. And since the events of 2001, we've had over 17,000 members of the Indiana National Guard alone service overseas, and today on January 12th, as we meet, we have approximately 1,275 troops worldwide with the Indiana National Guard. One very positive development relative to conflicts overseas, though, that has occurred in the last 12 months is that all of our troops have been withdrawn from the country of Iraq. And as someone who voted against the invasion of that country, I view that as a very positive development. The same is not necessarily true of Afghanistan. The president, about a year and a half ago, announced a surge policy. Troop strength was increased, and by the summer of this year, we had approximately 100,000 troops in Afghanistan. Today, as we meet in January in East Chicago, we have about 90,000 troops. And the president has indicated during this year he anticipates a drawdown of that number of about 23,000. But the president has also indicated he anticipates that we will have troops in Afghanistan through the year 2014. As I told other audiences representing our interests in Washington, I do disagree with the president's policy and do think it is time to have all of our troops withdrawn from that country. The ultimate cost of these conflicts is clearly measured in the loss of life, those who died Friday as well as before, those who were injured, as well as those who gave their time and energy and talent in their service to this country. But Joseph Stiglitz, a Nobel laureate who was raised and grew up in Lake County, Indiana, has also indicated that there's a significant financial cost too. His belief is that these two conflicts, Iraq and Afghanistan, will ultimately cost the American people somewhere between $5 to $7 trillion. And every one of those dollars has been borrowed because we have not paid for the war. Which brings me to the issue of the debt and deficit. I am very upset and frustrated that over the last year since we met in this room, the Congress and the President have not adequately, to any great degree, dealt with this issue. Now, the fact is that the President did have a commission, the Simpson-Bowles Commission, if you remember, that reported in December of 2010 and had approximately $3.9 trillion worth of recommendations to reduce the deficit over some years. They themselves, the Presidential Commission, did not have the requisite votes to send their recommendations to Congress. Congress could obviously have independently voted on the recommendations, chose not to do so. This summer, a select committee was appointed in Congress to try to find $1.5 trillion worth of deficit reduction. And as I think most people remember by news reports in November, they came up empty-handed. I do want to assure you, I have tried to do my best. And the example I would hold out to you is my service on the Energy and Water Appropriations Subcommittee in the House of Representatives. In the last Congress, I was chairman of that committee. In this Congress, I am the ranking Democrat on that committee. But over the last 2 years, working with my now chairman, Rodney Frelinghuysen, a Republican from New Jersey, and all of the members of the subcommittee in a bipartisan fashion, we have, as I like to call it, tried to take care of our own yard. And over the last 2 years, have reduced spending on energy and water projects across this country by $1.4 billion. In some instances, we believe programs could be eliminated. We had a carbon capture program for a coal fire plant in West Virginia. We decided it could be eliminated. That was a savings of $187 million. In other areas, we did reduce funding in accounts for renewable energy research. Over the last 2 years, spending has been cut by $400 million. But we simply didn't cut each account equally within that category, looked at each program. And in several, we decided we really needed to invest more money if we are going to have a stronger economy in the future. One of those is industrial technology. You think about the industry in East Chicago, Indiana. You want to make sure those who make things in America stay here and use as little energy as possible. And we did increase investment in that account by $20 million this year. And additionally, we certainly have to reduce our dependency on foreign oil and did increase spending for vehicle technology research to get more miles per gallon by $19 million. But in total, I did see a reduction overall in the subcommittee of $1.4 billion. But as we meet here this afternoon, I would remind you that my first priority, and it has always been, is the issue of creating jobs. We had the unemployment statistics that were recently published Friday of this past week. A year ago, unemployment in the United States was 9.4%. Today, it's 8.5%. There's some discernible progress, but you have 13,100,000 Americans who are still unemployed. You have people who are underemployed in great numbers in this society. And it remains an intractable problem. We created 200,000 jobs in this economy in the month of December, and that's good news. But the Brookings Institute has also indicated that we would have to create 208,000 jobs a month, every month, through 2024 to put us back where we were in 2007. So we've got a ways to go. And the fact is, this is obviously critical to the individual families involved. This is important to the vibrancy of our economy, but also it has a huge impact on our deficit. The Congressional Budget Office has indicated if we were at full employment, which is defined as 5.2% unemployment, a third of the deficit would go away. And the question is really, where are we going to start? My prescription, if you would, is that we have got to rebuild our physical infrastructure in the United States of America. You think about the needs in this community as far as roads and bridges, you think about our waterways, our airports, our water treatment facilities, wastewater. The American Society of Civil Engineers indicated that in 2010, our economy nationally was probably about $130 billion smaller than it could have been, except for our deteriorating infrastructure. They also suggest that we need, as a nation, to invest about $2.2 trillion to bring it up to good working condition. We live here in places like East Chicago. I live in Maryville, Indiana. We don't have to look far for examples. In our state alone, there are 4,091 bridges that are designated as deficient or obsolete. And we're here in East Chicago. Everyone understands what the status of Klein Avenue is. I'm assuming everybody in this room has been on Indianapolis Boulevard in Hammond. There's a bridge over to Gibson Rail Yard. It is a four-lane bridge, but you can only drive on two of them. You have a bridge in Gary, Indiana, on Martin Luther King Boulevard, over the Borman Expressway, and it is closed. We need to make an investment. And the logical question is, Pete, where are you going to get the money? My response is very simple. Everyone in our society needs to pay their fair share. I am convinced that everybody in this room and the people of East Chicago and Northwest Indiana pay and have paid more than their fair share. The fact is, that's not true across this country. There were 30 companies between 2008 and 2010, including companies such as General Electric and Boeing, that made a collective profit of $160 billion and did not pay 1 cent in corporate income tax. And I don't think that's right. You have, at this moment, firefighters and police officers in East Chicago who are sworn to risk their life for us and our safety. They pay a greater percentage of their income and income tax to the federal government than 25 hedge fund managers did in 2010, who made $22 billion, and we're not keeping any of us safe. And I just don't think that's equitable in our society. You had tax cuts that were proposed and passed when President Bush came into office in 2001. I voted against it. President Obama agreed to their extension for a 2-year period of time. It is anticipated that between 2001 and the end of this year, when they're set to expire, they will cost the Treasury in lost revenue about $2.7 trillion. And as I have told other groups throughout the week, I just hope it has appreciably changed and improved your standard of living. But I assume it has not, because it was not necessarily meant for people in this room in the city of East Chicago. And additionally, it was sold as a job creations proposal in that it would help business to stimulate the economy and hire people. Except in 2001, the federal government had a budget surplus. We have a budget deficit today. And you think about what the economy looked like as President Clinton left office and what it looks like today, and I don't think we got our money's worth. And the other very concerning thing, particularly for Cassandra's generation, is we borrow every dollar. Now, I do not propose that we throw it all out, but it is time for Congress to begin to examine each element of it and make a decision as to what we should keep, what we should change, and what we should repeal. But as we proceed, I have also of the belief that Congress is going to have to begin
ought to more closely follow the example of local officials here in Northwest Indiana. The fact is there is a lot of cooperation and communication that takes place for the improvement of all of us in our society. The example I have used in the East Chicago Police Department and city administration has been very active in it, is the HIDA designation for Lake and Porter County, a high-intensity drug trafficking area. I don't like the designation, but it provides the two counties and the departments within $3.1 million working through the HIDA to cooperate more effectively with each other, to gather and share intelligence more ably. And the success of that cooperation, I think, was noted by our U.S. Attorney Dave Camp when he announced in November that the local departments, including East Chicago with the HIDA, and federal officials have resolved more than 20 outstanding homicides as an example. So it is that type of cooperation, if you would, that really needs to take hold of the institution of the United States Congress. As we proceed, and I would close on this observation, I do harken back to the survey indicating 53% of American parents think their children are going to be worse off. I again have reiterated throughout the week, that is not the country my parents left me, and I have no intention of leaving that type of country to children either. It will continue to work in 2012 as hard as possible and in a cooperative attitude to try to finally bring some resolution to these issues. But with that, the remarks are closed. I do not have cards, and I'd be happy to open it up to the floor. And if there's any difficult questions, I will have to sample this. And I'm not kidding. I wish you're all perfectly happy with everything. Yes, sir.
First of all, thanks for coming to Chicago. My name is Clifford Raymer. I'm a resident here all my life. I'm at 4720 Railroad Avenue. I asked you for assistance, and you helped me. I appreciate that. I'm also now reiterating that request to help me again to maybe request that HUD looks into the housing situation here in Chicago. Because we're still having that same problem. We requested a town hall meeting with HUD officials back in 2010. We still haven't got it. So I'm asking you again to maybe help us out again to see if we can get an official from HUD to come in and look at the situation. Mr. Bruce Nazareth told me to let him know that I did speak to him.
I appreciate the thank you and also the observation about the housing department. If you would, if you could see a member of our staff before you leave, so we can get back to you, we would be happy to follow up on your request. I cannot, as with anybody here, promise you that we're going to get positive results, but we will do our best. So do see something before you leave.
Congressman, it's a pleasure seeing you again, and thank you for coming to our city. A question I have with the opinion that you stated earlier that you did not agree with the current administration about our troops staying in Afghanistan. In your opinion, what would you do, or do you think that they should all be withdrawn? Do you have a plan, a time frame when you would like to see them all come home?
I do not have a plan in my own mind, because you would not want to just willy-nilly or overnight withdraw those troops.
Right.
I am on legislation in the Congress, though, that would call for the Department of Defense and the administration to come up with a reasonable timetable, and not 2014, but obviously much more immediately, that coincides to ensure the safety of the troops who are there. And it really gives a good deadline to the Afghan government that, listen, time's up, and for better or for worse, you are going to have to take care of your own affairs. We have been unsuccessful today in having that type of resolution passed. We had a vote on one during consideration of the defense authorization bill in 2011. So again, I would not suggest that by February 1st, I don't have a plan, because again, that is for the military officials to make sure the troops are safe as they are withdrawn.
And do you see the United States staying on target? Are we going to be able to develop those and keep up with those, developing 200,000 jobs a month? Do you see that happening?
I do believe, even absent government action, it's not as though the government goes away, does nothing, but short of some fundamental action, which I do think we ought to take, that the economy incrementally will continue to get better. But I think it's going to be a very painful process. The recession, it's a huge hole in our economy in 2008, is unlike any I have ever experienced myself. Because that week in October, it just stopped. And the problem I see as far as significant new growth is that the surveys still indicate that one out of every four homeowners in America have a mortgage. If they have a mortgage, it's worth more, or it's higher than the value of their home now. So if I'm in a home and my mortgage is more than my house, that's going to constrict my ability to go out there and start jump-starting the economy. I would hazard a guess everybody in this room who has a thrift plan or a 401k plan has one that is worth less today than it was on October 1st, 2008. People are concerned about their retirement and say, well, the first place I have to put that money, not unintelligibly, is in that retirement account. And I do think that 13.1 million grievously undercounts the number of people who need help as far as jobs. It's also, and I've talked to people, are very underemployed in this economy right now, and for young people, as well as those who are older, it's kind of two spectrums right now, it is tough to get work. So I think it will be gradual, and that is why I do believe the government has responsibility. The president has a jobs bill. We have not had a vote on it during the year. And I tell people, doing something in the present is better than doing nothing. My concern is, even with the president's proposal, more than half of it is a tax cut. And I said, the Democratic Party, without being partisan of my position, the party I could, we built and we did infrastructure. That's how I think you help business, is you have clean drinking water in your city, you have good sewage, your roads are okay, your rail transport, and then business is going to find you. And those are living wage jobs. I thought those are our kind of jobs in Northwest Indiana. And then I'm not collecting unemployment, I'm paying tax, and then there's business, economic activity again. What I don't want to do is borrow the money to do it. I'm tired of doing that. And that's why I said again, I do think there's other ways to raise revenue without raising tax rates or without imposing even more burden on the middle class that's kind of picking up the tab for everybody right now. But I really think the government has a role in short of that. It's going to be still very painful and very long in process. I also think our financial institutions, and not necessarily our community banks that are wedded to our communities, but these international institutions that we bailed out. And I voted against the bank bailout, but we bailed them out. Hey, they got to start belling up to their auditors. And every time you turn around now, they're blaming the government. Well, we have to increase our capital requirement. Well, yeah. What were you doing in the first place? Well, we can only have 3% of our things in hedge fund now. Well, yeah, you're a bank. You're not a brokerage firm. But listen, the taxpayers of this country saved your corporation. You've got some responsibility in return here, too. So absent government action, I think it will get better, but it's going to be tough. People are obviously very concerned about the slowdown in China. They're very concerned about the events in Europe. And obviously, if something comes unglued in Europe, I think the Europeans will do whatever they can to make sure that doesn't happen. Because it is an international economy, obviously that would be a big bump in the road for us right now.
Thank you.
Do you have a position on the Alaskan pipeline?
Are you talking about the Keystone pipeline?
Yes.
Yes. I do have a position on it, and I support its construction. The Keystone pipeline is a proposal to build a pipeline to bring petroleum products from Canada essentially to the state of Texas. Very controversial. I do support it. The State Department, because it is an international pipeline, had to do an environmental impact statement as opposed to EPA. They did, and it was positive in that you could build it and you wouldn't have significant environmental degradation. As you probably know, the President this past November, December, withheld final approval and suggested he would wait until after November of 2012 to make a decision. I respectfully disagree with the President because, okay, we have an election, but we can't keep putting decisions off. That's why we get hired. Sometimes there's a reason to defer, but you can't do that indefinitely. The environmental community continues to harbor great concern. Those who want more production and petroleum in the United States are concerned as some of that will be exported, but hopefully some of that will inure to our benefit. I do think we have got to move away from petroleum products, but we're not going to do it tomorrow morning, so some production and some additional supply is not hurtful. The latest status, technically, is that if you remember right before Christmas, we passed a bill, I was opposed to extend a payroll tax cut for 2 months. Included in that were a couple of other provisions, including a requirement that the President make a decision by February 29th. Having said that, everybody here is from New Chicago, you're very practical people. What is going to happen between now and February 29th? One, we go back into session on the 17th. And negotiations as to what happens on March 1st are taking place. And as I have described it to others, I think there will be some obfuscation. And we will bumble along, and I think on March 1st, call me and tell me I was wrong. I don't think a final decision will have been made. And I think that's a mistake. And if the President wants to disapprove it, that's fine too. That's his prerogative. But I really do think we've got to start making some decisions.
Can you comment on the market plan and projects recently that have made progress toward your vision and what you see moving forward, or what you'd like to see
right. With
the market plan moving
forward? The longest term, what I would like to see with the market plan is, and this is literally 100 years, I think, in the end, given Northwest Indiana, is that up to 75% of the lakeshore from the eastern boundary of Portage to the Illinois state line be open for open public use, and I would add the word free. As I tell people, that lake is this incredible resource, and everybody ought to have access to it no matter what their station in life. You ought not to have to pay to get to Lake Michigan. You ought to have continuous trail along there. From my perspective, that is not only the right thing to do as far as the lake and public availability to it, but I think it makes sense for economic development. I look at Chicago, and obviously somewhat it's apples and oranges, but I think a lot of the vibrancy on the west side of Lakeshore Drive is because of what's not on the east side. And you have all that open space, and you also have commercial operations. You have Navy Pier, you have a casino in East Chicago. I think everything's compatible here. I also tell people, of all the things I've worked with, and it gets back to the issue of cooperation, very heartened with what has happened. In 2003, the mayors of the five cities, including East Chicago, signed an intergovernmental agreement to proceed. Today, and all five mayors are different. In all five cities, they are proceeding with the plan. So I am heartened that, one, again, people see some value. They have cooperated, and they've stayed the course. And so it's not just, it wasn't one person. I have also used East Chicago as one of the two examples of what I see happening here. The other is quarries where you had an industrial dump site for National Steel that is now open to the public. And I think it's going to lead to new economic development in Portage to the south. In East Chicago, the example I use, and the mayor has followed through on this and has done a great job, is you had a water filtration plant. It was on the lake. That's where people built them back then. It has to be rebuilt. I tell people I could not have been critical of the previous administration for rebuilding it on site. It's where it was. But the decision by the city of East Chicago was, you know, if we move it inland, we free up about 10 acres on the lake for new type of potential development and used by all the citizens. I said, that's what, it's good decision making. And you put, you know, 10 acres, what's 10 acres? It's 10 acres. And then you combine it with 63 acres and what's going on with Mayor Spahuri and Whiting, I think you're going to see progress in the other communities as well. So I'm very heartened, and, you know, I'm in public, but I can take the short-term view sometimes. But I think this is one where, again, all five mayors in the cities have taken a real long view. We will all be gone and forgotten. And people will still be putting these pieces together, and somebody will be out there recreating, somebody's going to have a commercial development, industrial, whatever it may be. And I'll be happy for it. Yeah, no, I'm just, that's something that makes me happy. And having done this before and not seeing any hands in the air, I will stop. But I will stick around for a few minutes. But again, thank you so much for being here and your officials. I really appreciate you being here today. And wish everybody a very good and successful year. Thanks so much.
Matt, oh, yeah, sure. Let me personally attest to this man's fortitude. He's been there for East Chicago. He touched on the water filtration plant. He helped us complete that project. When he ride over the bridge here, you will see he helped us do that. We are going to embark on doing Todd Avenue from 140th. Down to 151st, has given us the baseline funds to do that. And they said, if you want to know a friend, be in need and see if he give you the deed. So he has done that, so I'd like to thank
you. Thank you.
Notice to rental property owners. Pursuant to East Chicago Municipal Code of Ordinances Title 11, Chapter 123, Rental Housing and Ordinance Number 090020, owners of rental properties are required to register annually at the East Chicago Building Department office located at 4444 Railroad Avenue in East Chicago, Indiana. They must pay an annual registration fee of $10. Per each dwelling or rooming unit. 2012 registration will commence on January 9th and received Monday through Friday between the hours of 9 a.m. and 3 p.m. A late fee shall be assessed in the amount of $100 for each dwelling or rental unit not registered by April 15th of 2012. Failure to register any and all rental properties utilized as rental housing shall constitute a violation of this chapter, and the owner shall be subject to a fine not to exceed $2,500 per unit. Registration forms and requirements are available at the Building Department office or on the East Chicago website at www.eastchicago.com and click on the building link. For more information, please visit or contact the Building Department at 391-8294. Notice to rental property owners. Pursuant to East Chicago Municipal Code of Ordinances Title 11, Chapter 123, Rental Housing and Ordinance Number 090020, owners of rental properties are required to register annually at the East Chicago Building Department office located at 4444 Railroad Avenue in East Chicago, Indiana. They must pay an annual registration fee of $10. Per each dwelling or rooming unit. 2012 registration will commence on January 9th and received Monday through Friday between the hours of 9 a.m. and 3 p.m. A late fee shall be assessed in the amount of $100 for each dwelling or rental unit not registered by April 15th of 2012. Failure to register any and all rental properties utilized as rental housing shall constitute a violation of this chapter, and the owner shall be subject to a fine not to exceed $2,500 per unit. Registration forms and requirements are available at the Building Department office or on the East Chicago website at www.eastchicago.com and click on the building link. For more information, please visit or contact the Building Department at 391-8294. Notice to rental property owners. Pursuant to East Chicago Municipal Code of Ordinances Title 11, Chapter 123, Rental Housing and Ordinance Number 090020, Owners of rental properties are required to register annually at the East Chicago Building Department office, located at 4444 Railroad Avenue in East Chicago, Indiana. They must pay an annual registration